Thank you. Thanks very much for inviting me to talk. It's great to be here. Now, I didn't check whether we can do audience participation, but I wanted to start by asking you to tell me your favourite Roald Dahl's book. Shout out for me.
The Twits,
the Witches. James and the Giant Peach. Anyone over here awake? BFG, good. The Twits, okay, well, here they all are. These are all of his kids' short stories. My personal favourite is this one, George's Marvellous Medicine. And, okay, at this point, one reason I do this is to check the sound's working. It should make a little ping for me. So, Bill, do you want to just check that that's going to ping? There we go. Good, we're in business. Okay, so those are the children's books. What about this? Does anyone remember this? This music? Yeah? What was this? This was the Tales of the Unexpected on a Saturday night. These terrifying short stories that Roald Dahl wrote. Some of them quite bizarre, a lot of them with twisted, weird endings. Here's the complete list of them, if you want to remember them. So we all know Roald Dahl as the author of these great children's books like the BFG and Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and these weird adult short stories, the Tales of the Unexpected. But what you may not know is that he was fascinated with medicine, and he always used to say if he wasn't an author, he would have liked to have been a doctor. So this evening, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to tell you about George's Marvellous Medicine. I'm going to tell you about Roald Dahl's Marvellous Medicine and five stories about Roald Dahl and medicine that he told me. And as you can see, they're called Lash, Bash, Crash, Rash and Dash. You see what I did there? And you'll see these were driven by his fascination with medicine and some medical tragedies which happened to him and his family, several of which he turned into triumphs with a lasting legacy. And then also you'll see how my early encounters with Roald Dahl, I was his doctor when he was a patient in Oxford. I was a junior doctor there. And they've influenced me and my career a little bit. And as you heard, I've brought copies of my book, Roald Dahl's Marvellous Medicine, which is going to give much more detail than I can cover tonight. And I'm not meant to wander away from the microphone because it's being filmed, but I'm going to anyway. I've discovered over the years there are some people who have faith, and as soon as they turn up, they buy the book. They know they're going to want it. They know they're out for an interesting evening. And there are some who hold back a bit, and they think, well, I'll wait and hear the talk and see what happens. And but I've also discovered if we pass the book round, once you hold it, feel it, touch it, smell it. So I have a few. It's £15 a go. All the proceeds go to these charities working in areas of interest to Roald Dahl. And I've come from Liverpool with a couple of boxes of books. I don't want to take them home with me. So the book I wrote back in 2015. And then based on the book, I ended up with a children's show called Roald Dahl's Marvellous Medicine, which I brought here to the festival in 2017. And it had a great run and sold out. So my talk tonight is partly based on the adult talks I gave, but I kind of discovered that a lot of the things that were in the kids' show were quite fun to bring into the adult talks anyway. I was also interested, so put your hand up if you are connected with the college, you're a physician, or in some way you've been here before. Okay, and then put your hand up if it's your sort of general public, you just came because you heard about it somewhere. Okay, it's a good mixture. All right, so I'm going to try and appeal to both groups and hopefully not use too many medical terms that people don't understand. So as you heard, I'm a doctor at the Walton Centre in Liverpool. I'm a researcher working especially on emerging infections, and I also spend a bit of time on science communication. This is our neuro centre in Liverpool. And my research, I head a group called the Brain Infections Group, and then also we have quite a large global program on brain infections, things like meningitis and encephalitis. And then I head the National Institute for Health Research, Health Protection Research Unit. This was the government, with some foresight in 2014, funding a research unit on emerging infections. And so we've worked on Ebola and Zika, and of course, over the past couple of years, COVID-19. And most recently then, I've become the director of the Pandemic Institute, which really consolidates a lot of our work on the pandemic to help us respond to emerging infections and future pandemic threats. And as you heard, I did get a Guinness World Record for creating the world's largest organ made of people. There it is. It's a big brain in Liverpool with more than 700 people in it. And I got a Guinness World Record for running the fastest marathon dressed as a doctor. But it wasn't that fast, and somebody's beaten me since then. And somebody's beaten our world's largest organ since then. So I'm thinking about my third Guinness World Record. So if anyone would like to participate, or better still, can think of something to do, let me know. And I do like Edinburgh. The plan was to come up today, give the talk, and stay for the weekend. But then it went wrong, and I have to go back tomorrow for some meetings. But I've talked here a couple of times at the college, which is a great institution in a fabulous building. But anyway, we better get on with our story. So the first story is called Lash, and it's about the night when I met Roald Dahl. And I was working, as I mentioned, as a junior doctor in Oxford, working for this very famous doctor called Professor Sir David Wetherall. And one of his patients who had been admitted was Roald Dahl. And I knew Roald Dahl was in the hospital, but I'd not yet met him. And I was on call that night, and it was late at night, and I'd finished all my work on the wards, and I was tapping away on the ward computer, writing up some research I'd been doing on malaria. If you're hearing noises, don't worry. This is our atmosphere. And so I was tapping away on the computer, and I realized that a patient had come past, and then I realized a few moments later they came past again. And I was sort of ignoring them, getting on with what I was doing. And they seemed to come past it again and again, each time more slowly. And eventually I realized that this person had stopped. And I heard this. I think they basically wanted to know what was it that I was doing that was so fascinating. And I heard this voice, booming voice, that said, "What are you doing?" And I looked up, and there was this really tall man looking down at me with sticking out ears and twinkling eyes, wrapped up in a great dressing gown. And it was almost like looking up at the BFG. But of course, it wasn't the BFG. It was the BFG's author, Roald Dahl himself. Anyway, we got chatting, and I told him a bit about the work I was doing. And after a while, he said to me, "Have you read any of my books?" And I said, this is about the work I was doing. He said, have you read any of my books? And I said, "Well, I've not read any, but I loved the film of The Jungle Book." Now, at this moment, he stopped and looked at me like this, quite sternly, and he was trying to work out, was this somebody who was just ignorant, or was this a great joke at his expense? And he decided it was a great joke, and he roared with laughter, and the nurses came out going shh and quieting us down. And we became good friends after that. And every third night when I was on call in the hospital, once I'd finished all my work, I'd go and chat with him in his side room. And we'd talk about all sorts of things, about life, about medicine, about literature, music, but especially medicine because of his interest. And one night he told me about his schooling, and he went to Repton School in Derbyshire. And this was in some ways a terrible school. If you misbehaved, you got whacked on the bottom with a cane. But also, there were some great things. Once a term, at the end of term, the local chocolate factory, which was in Bourneville, the Cadbury factory, would send a box of their newly invented chocolates, and they were sent to the boys to try to see which ones they liked. And they were asked to give them scores out of 10, and they could write comments. And Roald told me that he remembers writing that one of them was too subtle for the common palate. And this was a 13-year-old schoolboy, so probably quite precocious. But this idea of inventing chocolates, of course, stuck with him as a child, and he kept hold of it for the next 20 or 30 years and eventually wrote a book all about it. And the book was Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, yeah. And he wrote about some of his childhood adventures in a book called Boy. I don't know if any of you have read Boy. Yeah, did you notice how it was absolutely stuffed full of references to doctors and illness and medicine? And this was because in his childhood, illness was really played an important part. And in fact, even before he was born, his father actually had suffered an illness. His father fell off the roof when his father was aged 14. And this is what Roald wrote about it afterwards. He said, "Somebody ran to fetch the doctor, and half an hour later, this gentleman made a majestic and drunken arrival in his horse-drawn buggy. He was so drunk that he mistook the fractured elbow for a dislocated shoulder." So he'd fractured his elbow. Now, the medics among you will know, the orthopods especially, that if you dislocate your shoulder, the way we put it back in is just to pull on the arm. But if you've actually fractured, if you've fractured the bone, then that can go badly wrong. And this is what happened. So they pulled as hard as they could until eventually the fracture went boing and the bone stuck right out, pretty horrid. And surgery being, I mean, the orthopaedic surgeons are still pretty crude in their methods, I would say. But back then they were especially crude, and the only way they could deal with this was just to chop his arm off at the elbow. And that's what they did. And if you look closely at this picture, you'll see that his left arm has been chopped off at the elbow there. Now, apologies to the non-medics. Is that hopefully you're okay with that? If anyone, there is some whiskey outside if needed. That's the end of our first story. Now, in a children's show, when you say that's the end of our first story and you show this slide, they all go. So we'll move on to our next story. The next one is called Bash, and it's about when Roald Dahl was in Africa. So he left school as soon as he could, didn't go to university, but wanted to work and wanted to travel and get some overseas experience. So he worked in Tanzania, or Tanganyika as it then was. Now, can any of you point to Tanzania on the map there? Come on, I want to see you point. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Yep, you're all absolutely right. It's just there. So he worked for Shell Oil in Dar es Salaam, and he caught malaria. And in fact, when I was working on the ward, writing up my notes, it was from my medical student elective. I'd been to Africa and studied malaria there, which was why I was so interested in what I was writing up. And he caught malaria, but actually it was something else that he was terrified of, not malaria. Does anyone know what he was terrified of in Africa? Snakes, yeah. He was terrified of snakes, and he wrote that if a black mamba bit you, you died within the hour, writhing in agony and foaming at the mouth. I couldn't wait. So he loved his time in Africa, though, and was really enjoying it. He was quite into his photography, and this is a picture he took of himself. He got somebody to take it. But then World War II broke out. The Germans invaded Poland. And so as soon as he could, he went from Tanzania to Nairobi so that he could sign up with the Royal Air Force. And unfortunately, on one of his early missions, his plane came down and crashed in the Libyan desert. And it burst into flames, and he was concussed. And this is what he wrote about it later. He said, "I think there was something wrong with the telegraph system between the body and the brain, but I believe a message eventually got through, saying, 'Down here, there is a great hotness. What shall we do?' Signed, left leg and right leg." Like I say, he was concussed and just coming round. And for a long time, there was no reply. The brain was figuring the matter out. Then slowly, word by word, the answer was tapped over the wires. "The plane is burning. Get out. Repeat. Get out. Get out." He did manage to get out. He crawled out on his hands and knees, and he couldn't see because he'd been blinded. But he survived, and he wrote about this in one of his short stories, A Piece of Cake. And then many years later, he wrote this in one of his kids' books. "I'm a wreck," groaned the centipede. "I'm wounded all over. My legs," he cried, "they're all sticking together. I can't walk, and my eyelids won't open. I can't see." And you can see how he based that in his kids' book from what had happened in real life. And that, once you start looking at his stories, and you know a bit more about him, you see how many things kept coming through in his short stories for adults, in his kids' stories. Does anyone know any of the Roald Dahl geeks who know where this is from? James and the Giant. Who's that? Very good. James and the Giant Peach. Are you a big Dahl fan? Yeah, good. Me too. So he survived this plane crash. He was taken to Cairo to the hospital there to recover. And this was the first time he really came across the nurses. And he recognised the doctor's skills in patching him up, but it was actually the nurses and their kindness that he really appreciated. And this carries on today through the Roald Dahl nurses. But he survived the crash and the spinal injuries, but he had multiple operations on his back, and he had lifelong back problems following that plane crash. And he couldn't carry on flying, and so he was... but he did want to carry on working for the Royal Air Force, so he was actually sent to Washington, where his job was basically to schmooze the Americans. They'd joined the war, but they hadn't really bought into it yet. And his job as a dashing war hero was to convince more of them that it was worth supporting. Anyway, anyone recognise this? Anyone know what this is? This is his writing hut, and he used to write there every day, a couple of hours in the morning, a couple of hours in the afternoon. And here he is with his wife, Lissy. And that's me with his wife, Lissy, and one of my kids. And we visited Lissy many years ago and visited the writing hut. And what we noticed, you can see there, that his chair had a hole cut in the back of it. And he'd done this himself to keep the pressure off his back because of this lifelong problem he had with it, with the back. And this was an early sign of his kind of inventiveness at dealing with medical problems that arose. And he had in his hut on the desk, he had all these artifacts from his life, which he would sometimes come back to if he needed inspiration for his stories. This was his hurricane fighter, a little model of that. This was a jar of spinal shavings from one of his operations. This was this great ball made up of chocolate wrappers, foil wrappers, from every day he used to eat a chocolate bar at one stage in his life. And it was really heavy, actually. And then this, of course, was the head of his hip bone, which he managed to convince the surgeon to give him after one of his hip operations. So after the crash, as I say, he went to the States, and it was here that he wrote his first short story called Shot Down Over Libya. And it was put in a newspaper there. And... this is the first writing he did that he was paid for. And he loved the idea that actually this bash on the head, this monumental bash on the head from his plane crash, was what had converted him into a writer. And there is certainly a well-described syndrome called acquired savant syndrome or sudden artistic output syndrome. I'm a neurologist. We had a patient like this in Liverpool some years ago who was a builder. No interest in art or poetry or anything like that at all. But following a head injury, he became a compulsive artist, as you can see. His house was actually covered in paintings. Even the walls, even the carpet at one stage. And he did sculpture. So it definitely exists, this syndrome, where people with no artistic interest really become driven and quite skilled. So Dahl liked this idea, but I wasn't ever convinced that this was completely true. And I'll show you why. You may recognise this. He wrote about a little girl who climbed out of bed in the middle of the night, tiptoed to the window, and peeped through a chink in the curtains. Does anyone know where that's from? You'd think that's from the BFG. You'd think that's Sophie. In fact, he first wrote that in a school essay when he was about 12 years old. But then, of course, he wrote something almost identical many years later when he was writing the BFG. And he'd always shown an ability to write. When he was in Africa before the crash, he used to write letters home to his mum every week, which were really funny, full of literary merit. But it may well be that even though he was always a writer, it may well be that the bash on the head just disinhibited him a little bit and gave him that freedom to write the kind of weird stories that he did, like about these two aunts that were squished by this giant peach. And some of his stories, especially the adult short stories, were quite weird and even a little bit sadistic. And in fact, when he first wrote his short stories, they were felt to be, some of them, not really appropriate for school kids. So, like I say, it may well be that the bash on the head was what released his inhibitions. Now, we sometimes do... I thought I'd left this in, but I hadn't, but I'm going to go back to it and put it in. Because it's the front part of the brain. If you all put your hand on your forehead like that, It's the front part of the brain, the frontal lobe, is what inhibits us. It's what controls us. It stops us doing things. So, you know, if you go into a restaurant, you may really fancy the soup over there. Most of us would, you can put your hands down now. Most of us would just say quietly to the waiter, what's that? You know, what have they got? That looks nice. But, you know, if somebody's disinhibited, they'll just go and stick their finger in and say, that's nice, I'll have one of them. So this is a test we use in clinic as neurologists to test people's frontal lobe to see if it's working and they can inhibit themselves. So I need a volunteer who's going to shout out for me the colours. Who'd like to do it? Yeah, my Roald Dahl friend will, won't you? What's your name?
Denise,
because you're a Dahl fan, aren't you? So shout out as loud as you can, because they want the microphones to pick it up. Shout out the colours that you see as loud as you can, quickly as you can.
Red, yellow, green, blue, red.
Perfect. Come on. None of you were willing to do it. Okay, I want you to do this. It's Ruth, is it?
Denise,
where did I get Ruth from?
No idea.
It's definitely Denise. Apologies. Do the same again. Read out. I want you to tell us again on the next slide the colours as quickly as you can. I don't want you to read the words. Just tell me the colours. First one's blue. Quick. No, the colour. What colour is it? So it's blue.
Blue, green, red, yellow, green, blue.
It's hard. It's hard. Let's all have a go together after three, okay? Everyone have a go, because I know you'll want to do it. Give me the colour. Blue.
Green, red,
quicker.
Blue, red,
it's hard. Okay. And the reason it's hard is because here your brain is just giving us the colour. Here, you're trying to give us the colour, but part of your brain wants to read the word out, and it's your frontal lobe that says, no, you idiot, he doesn't want the word, he wants the colour. So this is a test of your frontal lobe function and whether you're disinhibited. But Dahl, like I say, was interested in this idea that the bash on the head had given him the artistic genius. I don't think it gave it him, but it may have released it. Now, we're going to think a bit more about the brain. And the brain has the nerves, which are the functional bits, but also there are other bits in the brain. There's spinal fluid, blood vessels, and white blood cells. And these are all going to be important for our next few stories. So spinal fluid washes the brain and keeps it moist and clean. The blood vessels obviously get blood to the important parts of the brain. And within the blood vessels are red blood cells and white blood cells. And the white blood cells fight infection. And they're going to be important in our next few stories. Is everyone okay with that?
Yep.
Okay, we'll move on. It's time for our third story, which is called Crash. So Dahl met the actress Patricia Neal in America and married her. She was a Hollywood actress and they started a family. And they split their time between America, where she needed to be for her acting career, especially she was in New York, and Great Missenden, the British countryside, where Dahl felt it was much nicer for writing his stories. And also he felt it was much safer to bring up a family there. And it turned out that he was correct, because in 1960, his son was involved in a road traffic accident when the pram was hit by a taxi. And he suffered brain damage. He survived the accident, but he was very poorly. This is what Dahl wrote about it just after the accident, and he was in hospital. He said, things looked grim. They were giving plasma to Theo. He was in a state of deep shock, colourless, high pulse, temperature 102. They didn't dare move him for x-ray. I suggested portable x-ray. They did this. I also arranged round-the-clock special nurses. This was very typical of him, taking charge and trying to help out. So Theo survived the accident, but he developed this condition called hydrocephalus, or water on the brain. And this is when the fluid, which is created in the centre of the brain, as you can see there, normally it flows round, but if somebody has hydrocephalus, the flow is blocked and it builds up the pressure. And the way we treat this is we put in a tube to drain it. We call it a shunt. And the tube has a valve as well to stop the fluid going back the wrong way. And the problem, so they did this operation on Theo in the 1960s, but the problem was the valve blocked. So they had to repeat the operation a few weeks later, and it blocked again. And it kept blocking. They did 8 operations altogether. And Dahl said to them, surely there must be something better than this valve that keeps blocking. And the surgeon said, no, there wasn't. So in typical Dahl fashion, he said, well, we'll invent one. And that's exactly what he did. So he got together with a toy maker called Stanley Wade, well, a toy maker, he was an engineer, and the neurosurgeon Kenneth Till, and they created this valve called the Wade-Dahl-Till valve. And thousands of them were used on children all around the world. And I remember when Dahl, we were discussing this, he basically asked me one night, he said, Tom, how's your writing going? How's your write-up going? And of the malaria stuff. And I said, well, it's coming on. And he said, where are you going to try and publish it? And I said, well, we're hoping to send it to The Lancet. And he said to me, oh, yes, The Lancet, that's quite a good journal. We published there a few years ago. And I thought, what are you talking about? And it turns out they had published on this valve in The Lancet. And then Dahl, as he quite often did, he then sort of got a bit shy and bashful about it and said, well, yes, we did publish, but I didn't really, you know, it was really the surgeon and Stanley Wade, the engineer. But when I came to write my book many years later and I looked at the article, the published article, but also I was allowed to look at the archives by the family and the letters, etc. And I noticed here is the... this is the article, and here's the in Dahl's notes was the handwritten, and basically he'd written the article, the first draft of the article himself. This is a device he created to test the pressure difference across the valve. So he was very involved in the whole thing, but he tended to be quite modest about his contributions to his medical work, which was interesting because when it came to his writing, he wasn't modest at all. He was an enormous boaster. But anyway... He did also, through his work on the valve, he got involved with the charities and other children who had hydrocephalus. And ultimately, this charity that he was involved with became Shine, which is one of the charities we're supporting through the sales of the book. And my own, I mentioned my own research on brain infections. And within our group, in recent years, we've also done some work on valves and shunts to drain fluid, and in particular, still the same problem that some of these shunts get infected and block up. And we did this large trial some years ago with our neurosurgeons to try and show which type of shunt was the best one. And again, this has actually changed practice. Moving on. So story number four is called Rash. And Dahl, the family got back to normal. Theo recovered. And they were back in Great Missenden. They were writing, he was writing one of his books. Can anyone see which book it is that he was writing? Yeah, this is Charlie. You recognize some of the characters. And everything seemed to be fine. And then one day, his daughter here, Olivia, who you can see, who was age 7, got measles. And they thought this was quite funny. She had these spots, red spots, which they called polka dots. And she seemed to be doing fine. But then as Roald wrote afterwards, one morning when she was well on the road to recovery, I was sitting on her bed showing her how to fashion little animals out of coloured pipe cleaners. And when it came to her turn to make one herself, I noticed that her fingers and her mind were not working together and she couldn't do anything. "Are you feeling all right?" I asked her. "I feel all sleepy," she said. In an hour, she was unconscious. And in 12 hours, she was dead. So this was terrible. She died of measles encephalitis. Encephalitis means inflammation and swelling in the brain. And this was in the 1960s. Roald wrote this 20 years later. He was devastated at the time, as you can imagine. But even 20 years later, when the vaccines came out, back in the 60s, there were no vaccines available. He couldn't understand why some parents wouldn't get their kids vaccinated. So he wrote this as part of a letter to parents to get their kids vaccinated. And he raised money, became a big campaigner for measles vaccination. And he knew that some parents were concerned about the side effects of the vaccine, but this is what he put in the letter. "The risk of serious side effects from measles immunization is about 1 million to 1 chance. The probability of a child choking to death on a chocolate bar is probably greater." And he was right, you know, these are very rare side effects and much rarer than the risks of the disease itself. And we still have difficulties getting people vaccinated against measles. And of course, we still have difficulties getting people vaccinated against other important emerging infections, even when you've got thousands of people killed around the world by this recent virus. We still have people who don't want to get vaccinated. Anyway, talking about vaccines and how they work. So these are slides I show in the kids show, but the adults seem to like them as well. Just talking about how vaccines work, and it's all about these white cells that I mentioned earlier fighting infections. So this is a real image of white cells. That's the big ugly thing. The red cells are those ones which we can ignore, and those are bacteria. Okay, and this video is a speeded up video showing the white cell chasing the bacteria. There we are. Yes. So it's caught it. Okay. Now let's see what happens if we allow the bacteria to grow with no white cells to stop them. Again, a speeded up video.
Oompa, oompa, doompa-dee-doo. I've got a perfect puzzle for you. Oompa, oompa, doompa-dee-dee. If you are wise, you'll listen to me.
Anyway, it's quite nice. Well, the kids liked it. In fact, what we got the kids to do then was dress up. This is on the stage in the show here in Edinburgh a few years ago. Got the kids to dress up as white cells and red cells and to chase the pathogen, the bug, all around the stage. And we even got some quite nice reviews. This is, they write ferocious reviews, don't they, for the festival? I mean, some of them are terrible. If I'd known, not mine, but some of the ones you read were terrible. I got quite nice ones. This is somebody in the list who said, what better way to teach us how vaccines interact with white cells than to get a group of kids up on stage dressed in appropriately coloured T-shirts to act it out? Anyway, we had such fun with the Roald Dahl show that more recently, this year, I came up and did a show called COVID for Kids, which again was a lot of fun, teaching kids how what's happened during the pandemic and how we fought it off. And again, it got some very nice reviews. And again, we work quite a lot on vaccines in my research group. This is a disease called Japanese encephalitis, which is a big problem across Asia with tens of thousands of cases every year. This is one of the children who survived the infection but was left with damage to their limbs, as you can see, and she really struggled to walk. And there's another one. And so we've, over the years, been involved in a big program to control Japanese encephalitis through vaccination, which involved producing surveillance so we can look for the disease, developing diagnostic tests, which are used across Asia, working out how much disability there is due to the disease and the cost of that, because these are the things that governments need to know. And then, of course, working on the vaccine. But interestingly, there had been a vaccine available for years, but governments just weren't using it because these other bits of the jigsaw weren't in place. And putting all of this together, we've had a large program across Asia since 2005 with millions of children vaccinated and about 800,000 cases and 200,000 deaths avoided. And interestingly, this program's actually saved money. It saved about $1 billion across Asia since then, because it's cheaper to vaccinate children than to look after sick children that have died from the problem. Anyway, we're going to move on to our fifth story, which is called Balderdash. And this is starts with Roald again back. He was devastated by Olivia's death and never really got over it. And in fact, didn't talk about it for many, many, many years. He got back to writing eventually in his hut. And everything seemed to be fine. His wife, Olivia, had just got an Oscar for her role in this film, Hud. And then tragedy struck again. And his wife, Patricia, had a stroke. So she was pregnant with their fourth child, and she had a stroke. And what happened was she had a ballooning. We call this an aneurysm. It's a ballooning of a blood vessel. And it ballooned, and then it leaked blood. And then this caused the stroke. And she nearly died. She had an operation to clip the ballooning, but she was left with right-sided weakness and difficulty talking. And this, back in the 60s, they were told, well, that's it, really. You might get, they suggested, maybe a bit of physio once every few weeks. And Roald Dahl, so I remember him telling me, he said, You know, he couldn't believe that she would ever get better and learn to talk again with just a little bit of input every couple of weeks. His children went to school for 6 hours a day. So he set that up. He set up a rehab program for Patricia. And for 6 hours every day, they had got her walking. They got family and friends and neighbors to come and talk with her. And amazingly, they got her back up on her feet and she got her speech back. So much back that she ended up acting again. And nobody could believe how this had happened. It was like a miracle. And so they wrote a book, particularly with the help of this woman who was a neighbour who had Valerie Eaton Griffiths with her name, who'd really helped with the programme. So they wrote a book about how they got her back. And then they set up a programme, initially in Oxfordshire and subsequently nationally and ultimately internationally. And this became the Stroke Association as we know it today. So Roald Dahl was involved right at the start of the Stroke Association. Who knew? I didn't know, and I didn't believe a word of it. He, like I said, he would mention some of these things, and then he'd go all shy. And I thought, oh, he's just, you know, he's a storyteller. He's just talking nonsense. And it was only when I came to write my book and look into everything properly that I found out that these things were true. And again, in our own research group, we're working on stroke. This is Laura Benjamin, who was a research fellow under me. She's now an independent investigator in London, working on HIV and stroke. But when Patricia was recovering her language and getting her speech back, she couldn't always get the right words out. And Roald thought this was really funny, these new words, these neologisms. She talked about a sooty swatch when she wanted to have a drink. She said, "Will you get me a sooty swatch?" I think it was a gin and tonic. And an obligon was a cigarette. She said it's peckerized, meaning it's all messed up. And yeah, Roald thought these were fabulously funny and roared with laughter and wrote them all down, as you can see. And of course, this idea made its way again into one of his books later on. Which book was that? The BFG, yeah. And these are some of the words he came up for the BFG, gobblefunk as the language was. And this is what Roald wrote in the BFG. You must simply try to be patient and stop scribbling. I know exactly what words I am wanting to say, but somehow or other, there is always getting squiddled around. What I mean and what I say are two different things. And this could have been Patricia talking. Yeah, you know, it's exactly the same problem as she had. So Roald Dahl then, from the 80s onwards, he really wrote some of his best children's stories, the George's Marvellous Medicine, the BFG, The Witches. Matilda was in 1988. And it was in 1990 when I met him when he was at the John Radcliffe Hospital in Oxford. And as I say, he was unwell. I mean, he'd had illnesses throughout his life. But when he came in under us, he had a type of bone marrow cancer called myelodysplasia. And this was transforming. It was becoming an even more nasty type of cancer called acute myeloid leukemia. And back then, we had no treatment for it. And I remember chatting with Roald late one night, and he knew he was going to die of this. And he said, "I'm not frightened of dying. I've seen my daughter do it, age 7. And if she can do it, I can." And he died on the 23rd of November in 1990. And if you go to Great Missenden today, this village in Buckinghamshire, you can see his gravestone there. And nearby, his wife Lizzie arranged for this great giant footstep to be put in. And since then, I stayed in touch with the family, especially with Lizzie. And I was chatting to her in 2015, and I was at her house there. And we were talking about some of the tales from way back when and the things Roald had told me. And she said it was her that encouraged me to write the book. She said, you know, she realised I was getting on a bit. And she said, basically, you know, you don't capture these things and write them down, they'll be lost forever. I mean, I didn't think I was that old, but I had been a rough day. So anyway, just as Roald used to tuck himself away in the garden shed, I tucked myself away in the attic for 6 months or so. I managed to write the book just in time to launch it on the 100th anniversary of his birth, 13th of September 2016. And it was a fun time. It was a fun event. We got back together. That was his son, Theo, came over from America with his wife. And you can see how many copies of the book they bought, ladies and gentlemen. And I did an event at the Cheltenham Literature Festival where I met Ed Balls and, John Simpson, yeah, and Richard Fries. I knew Richard Fries anyway, because I'd done, before that, when the book came out, I did Saturday Live with him and some others, and there was a lot of coverage in the papers. So this was all good fun. And then, of course, the show was here at the Edinburgh Festival, and BBC filmed that. I became a little bit of a lovey, I'm afraid, and carried on doing media stuff. And in fact, it was on Christmas Eve that I was doing the Christmas University Challenge, you know, when they get celebrities and other hangers-on like me. And actually, it was on the 31st of December when the news came through to me, because I was the director of the Emerging Infections Research Unit. This news came through. Somebody asked me to look at this coming out of China, this virus. And because of the Health Protection Research Unit, we were in a position to very quickly get ready to respond in the UK in terms of the research program. So that actually we activated our program mid-January, so that by the end of January, we were ready. This is a national program to study hospitalized patients called ISARIC-4C. And we were ready to recruit patients, hospital patients right across the country. So the first patients were in our study. And in fact, we've had more than 300,000 in the study, led from Liverpool by someone called Callum Semple, but also someone called Ken Bailey here at the University of Edinburgh, who's very heavily involved in running that program. And so there's been, of course, all sorts of science happened during the pandemic. Some of the other things we did from Liverpool was this testing of mass testing to see whether it worked. So you'll remember at the start of the pandemic, we only tested people who had symptoms, and there was a big question, should we be testing everyone? So in Liverpool, we did the study, and we showed that indeed we should be testing everyone, and that helps bring cases down. And then also we did the first party event in Liverpool as well as part of the events research program. And so on the back of all this new work, we've set up the Pandemic Institute, a collaboration between the academic units in the city, but also the city region and the city council, because of this new unique partnership. And we set it up last year, but it's a very active programme. We've got quite a lot of money, but if there are any millionaires in the audience who would like to contribute, come and have a chat with me afterwards. I may even give you a free copy of the book. And through the pandemic, I've done quite a lot of work on the telly as well, Moral Maze, Question Time, etc. And we launched the Scouse Science podcast, which we record them live, but then they're all available on your normal podcast providers. So, and this was one we did with Matt Hancock that was quite fun. And then I came back and did the COVID for Kids back here at the Edinburgh Festival this year. So it is Christmas. So we better get towards the end with what Roald Dahl had to say about Christmas. And this was a poem he wrote called Mother Christmas. He wrote it in 1988, and I think it's really great. Where art thou, Mother Christmas? I only wish I knew why Father should get all the praise and no one mentions you. I'll bet you buy the presents and wrap them large and small, while all the time that rotten swine pretends he's done it all. So hail to Mother Christmas, who shoulders all the work, and down with Father Christmas, that unmitigated jerk. It's good, isn't it? But we should finish with Roald Dahl's, his favourite poem, and he told me about this shortly before he died. He said his favourite was this: my candle burns at both ends, it will not last the night, but ah, my foes and oh, my friends, it gives a lovely light. And I think that's quite poignant. But my favourite quote that he wrote is really this, I think, because he wrote it about the BFG, but really it could have been written about him. Giants is never dying. Mostly us giants is simply going on and on like whiffsy time twiddlers. And I think Roald Dahl's legacy did go on because, as well as his wonderful writing, we have the marvellous medicine, the valve, which was used on thousands of children around the world, his impact on vaccination, that letter is still reproduced today, and of course the Stroke Association, which goes from strength to strength. And as I mentioned, the book proceeds, all the royalties from the book go to the charities working in areas that were supported by Dahl, which is why I don't mind shamelessly flogging it. And also tonight, Proceeds from tonight's event are going especially to the Roald Dahl's Marvellous Children's Charity, who support these Roald Dahl nurses all around the country. There are about 30 of them, supporting over 24,000 seriously ill children. It's a fabulous charity. I've done some work with them, especially in Liverpool, and they're brilliant nurses. And they particularly fill in the gaps, the kind of illnesses like encephalitis, which are rare, some of the rare blood disorders, the ones that don't get all the attention, which is usually cancer, but are equally important in their own ways. So I think that's me done. I'm going to finish with the final song.
Bang, bang.
Thank
bang, bang,
you for your attention bang, bang. And give you some music. Thank you very much.